The idea of being normal, going to school and being like a CPA or something like that, you know. And it just seems like there's got to be more exciting ways to make a living. And it's also a good way to travel and get paid for it. I don't see myself ever having getting out of Massachusetts when I did, you know, and getting paid $10 a day to do it, you know. It's really cool. Get in a van with like your best friends and just go. It's so much fun.
Oh, just a big run.
End.
Yeah, absolutely. Just something. If it works.
I had heard a tape with Scruffy the Cat. I heard the first tape they made in December of 82. I think it was. And I thought it was great. And that's when I decided I wanted to be in the band. And it was just a matter there of working it my way in. And it was like 9 months later that I got into the band. I want to go back to school at some point. I don't know when. As soon as the band fizzles out, I'll go back. It's got to at some point. It can't go on forever. I mean, we're not the Rolling Stones.
Just do like, just leave out.
The best thing about spray painting is, of course, the fact that it's poisonous. And you should always do it in a room with closed windows. Always do it in a room with closed windows and do it for about 3 or 4 hours. Then you find the next day when you wake up, if you wake up, that every part of your body hurts because you poisoned yourself. This is our specialty paint. And you get to know the paints by the smells. The different colors smell different. So whatever they use in the, whatever they use for pigment, one of them, and I can't remember what it is, smells just like bubble gum. I think it's cerise. And the different kinds of black smell different. Some colors are really difficult. Green and orange tend to be really difficult. Let's see. There we go.
It's Hank.
Work for companies that need things written. If I finish writing one of these things, these projects, then I can leave and go on tour and play out of town, things like that. So I think that's what everybody looks for when they're in a band, is a job that, you know, pays you enough to get by so you can have the flexibility to be in a band, because it's a, there are very few jobs like that.
I knew Charlie from his other bands. Yeah, like 6 years ago, The Law. He and Mac were in a band called The Law from Iowa. And then when I was at school at Princeton, I saw them perform and thought they were the greatest thing. And I kept in touch with Charlie. And I was working in Miami as a newspaper reporter for the Miami Herald. And I ended up keeping in touch with Charlie for years. And when I moved to Boston, got in touch with him. And he was just getting Scruffy the Cat together with Steven at that point.
Teletron, can I help you?
I'm not saying.
Best available would be seats in the first bow. Teletron, can I help you?
Okay. Again, it's for five seats? Yeah.
I'm going to take three of them.
Okay.
Check one minute and second. I think they may have gone off sale here at Teletron. Yeah.
It's
going to
be the balcony. Or back room.
I'm pretty happy with the way things are going now. It could be better, but I'm happy to be like a janitor or something and play music at this point.
It's really cool that like things get taken out of your hands a little, because in the early days it was all us. It was like ask your friends to go to gigs, make all the posters and stuff like that, which was fun, but like a drag. And it's also kind of fun to, like, now there are other people involved in it, and it as a career is, like, starting to move itself instead of, like, you having to push it all the time.
We get all our gear in the back of this cab, and we all get in the other cab, and we go to the gig, and we'd sit there, like, sometimes 2 or 3 in the morning, or 3 or 4 in the morning after the gig, waiting for a cab because they don't want to pick you up.
If we get some kind of success, you know, like get to be on MTV all the time and, you know, open for the Del Fuegos or like, you know, play places like the Centrum or something, like, if that's the natural progression for a band like us to go in, then that's cool.
It's not like someone's going to come up to Scruffy the Cat and say, if you do this, this, and this, we'll make you famous, because they don't care. They don't care about us, and there's not really much we could do to make ourselves be like that. We can't, like, put on stupid clothes and sing songs a particular way. You know, it's fortunately not an opportunity that presents itself. You know, everyone talks about, I would never sell out. I don't think anyone had ever asked me to.
I would like to be able to travel around the country and play the music that we play in front of new audiences that appreciate it, and just see the quality of the music get better and better, as well as to continue along the kind of course we set for ourselves. But if you set up some kind of like artificial goal, like, you know, we want to be as big as Van Halen or something, then you're constantly disappointed.
If the band is successful, that would be wicked cool.
I'm
How are you, Steve?
Not too bad.
Steve Fredette of Scruffy the Cat. So now, Scruffy the Cat, a new record coming out next week called Tiny Days.
Tiny Days.
Tiny Days. Mm-hmm. What a cute name.
Isn't that nice?
It's a cute name, Tiny Days.
Kind of goes with cute Scruffy the Cat.
Cute Scruffy the Cat, of
course. It's not meant to be cute.
What? Tiny Days?
Tiny Days are actually awful things.
Oh, all right. Tell us all about it then.
Tiny Days, well, it's a song that Charlie wrote. And it's about when your life just, like, shrinks down and your days are only 2 hours long.
Yeah, in other words, like, there's not enough days in the week to get all this stuff done.
Or when there's, you just don't do anything.
Ah, and waste the whole day.
Yeah, so those are Tiny Days.
Up, Randall.
Yeah, it's cold beer. Wake up.
Wake up,
pretty. Yeah. I woke up this morning at like 6:30 and had to go to the bathroom. We came out of the bathroom and Randall was laying on his back. His t-shirt all pulled all the way up. His legs spread out. His hand gripped around the beer.
It was 2:30 to Fargo, and then it's another 2:30 to 3:40. That's about 600 miles from Minneapolis to Winnipeg, too.
Mm-hmm.
Winnipeg to Saskatoon is 3:30. Oh, that's a hike and a half.
It's only booked to Los Angeles at this point. We're not booked back yet. We're assuming that we're going to come back through the Southwest, but that could be like a very brash assumption on our part at this point.
Maybe Saskatoon. That's not as bad as I thought it was going to be. But what's going to be bad after Edmonton to Calgary is going to be Calgary to Vancouver.
Because that's to the mountains.
Because that's to the Rocky Mountains.
This is great. I've never been down any of these places.
Time for the world premiere.
Okay.
All right, now you put your hand on the radio.
Okay.
And we're going to start playing this, and we'll play it again and again and again and again.
All right.
And the album will come out Tiny Days, April 15th. Record release party at the Paradise in the First.
Everyone come down to Paradise.
You guys are a great band and getting better all the time and getting more and more fans. And here we go. Here it is.
All right.
Thanks, Steve.
Well, the problem we had all along that eventually, you know, came to this kind of bad juncture was just none of us ever really said what we were thinking about each other or each other's musical contributions. So one by one, we all built up what started out as real petty complaints, but then built into an overall bad feeling. And their way of getting rid of this bad feeling was to fire me. And in some ways, getting rid of me doesn't solve all those problems, but maybe they'll be able to work them out amongst themselves. But it was pretty unpleasant. The thing is, it just, you know, to have a lot of petty things kind of marked up against you, and criticisms, you know, of your, you know, style and or personality are pretty personal things to deal with, as opposed to when you're not playing well enough, which is, you know, how well do you have to play to be a rock band, you know? Personalities do enter into it. You can't ignore it. You know, you spend enough time with people, it's like being chained together, you know, for months. Being in a rock band doesn't make you a better person. And over a period of years, I think it makes you probably a worse one, because you get very narrow-minded, very short-sighted. Everything tends to be, you're in a certain world that's very small. I mean, you know, if you're in a club scene or an American rock scene or anything, it's very small and very predictable. And the thing is to use it to try to be original, and that's what we were doing. I thought we were being pretty innovative in some ways, and my role in the band has always been to try to, you know, what I would like to do is to incorporate some odd elements into rock and roll, which, like the banjo or other acoustic and folk instruments. But that really wasn't the direction that they wanted to go. I can't say that I don't miss it, but I can't say that in some ways I'm probably better being out of the band.